Hey everyone, Sean here. Just jumping in to apologize for how long it's taken this episode to come out. I know it's been a couple months, but we've been having a few hardware and software issues that have now been rectified, but it's taken a lot longer than we thought to get this episode out, and there was a period of time where we weren't sure it was even going to come out. So I just wanted to thank you all for your patience, and let's get on with the episode. Thanks. Bye.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to another episode of the Weird Biology Show podcast. I'm your host today, your chief amphibian robotics evangelist, Dan.
And I'm Sean, your favorite android that dreams of electric sheep.
And today, we're going to be talking about frog robots.
These goddamn liberals are turning the friggin' frogs into robots!
Whoa, Alex, I didn't realize you were here today.
All right, so today we're going to be talking about a research paper called A Scalable Pipeline for Designing Reconfigurable Organisms. This was a collaboration between the Department of Computer Science at the University of Vermont and the Department of Biology at Tufts University in Massachusetts. So what we're going to talk about today is actually quite literally, they made frogs out of robots.
Well, they made robots out of frogs. Yeah, it's pretty freaky how it's possible, right?
Yeah, they made like little, I guess you can actually call them almost nanomachines out of frog cells.
Dear listener, please, if you can, just picture like a clump of cells, and then picture that clump of cells as like a tooth, but a tooth that can walk. That's what we're looking at here. They're very bizarre looking when you actually see them.
Oh, absolutely. So I guess where to start is we should actually cover machine learning, because
yeah, absolutely.
If any of you haven't heard of machine learning, it's actually kind of what the name implies. It's an algorithm, or, you know, in layman's terms, a program that's capable of learning. Someone writes it to be able to take in data and learn, make predictions based on this data. And the reason we're going to talk about that a little bit is because their whole process here actually started with a whole lot of machine learning and algorithms, so I want everybody listening along to be able to, you know, follow along and understand what's going on.
Yeah. You gotta build robots to make robots.
Essentially, or at least program robots to make robots. So, like I already said, machine learning is effectively what the name implies. You know, you have a program that's capable of learning, revising, looking at data, making predictions. You have your standard program. It's programmed to take in an input and return an action based on what you did. Some of them are very advanced, can take in a lot of actions, or a lot of different actions, but at the end of the day, it's kind of, you know, predetermined what it's going to do, how it's going to react to what you do. Machine learning is kind of different in that, you know, it's going to take in different inputs, but it's going to change what it puts out in response. So that's really the big differentiation. Now, how this is useful is because, you know, we're basically going to be talking about the beginnings of AI here today.
Right.
So machine learning is basically what AI works off of. They use machine learning to then create something called deep learning, which is basically just machines mimicking the neural pathways of the human brain. It's fascinating. And despite having a bunch of experience trying to think about it, still makes my head hurt.
It sounds spooky, too.
It's a little bit spooky. Then they take this deep learning, which is basically them just mimicking the human brain with a program. And that's the basis for your AI, you know, your sci-fi shit, your HAL 9000.
I'm afraid I can't let you do that, Dave.
In fact, I think it was recently, I don't know how recently, but relatively recently, they actually created an AI that beat some game master's own game. I forget what the game was. It wasn't chess.
I was going to say, because there was that old Russian supercomputer that beat a Grandmaster like back in the 50s or 60s.
Yeah, I'm going to say it was like Go or something like that, one of those games.
Ooh.
But either way, it's crazy. You know, this is the future. The future is now. So
we can't let the robots beat us at games we invented.
Well, hopefully they're a pretty long way away from that, because right now they're just little blobs of frog cells.
Fortunately, yes.
So I guess now hopefully, you know, everybody listening kind of has a basic idea of what's powering this thing. Because now we're going to start talking about how they made the robots out of frogs. So they actually had, you know, quite a complicated process, actually. So they start out with this machine learning algorithm I talked about. They actually came up with an algorithm. It was kind of crazy, but they created a program to simulate the process of evolution. So they're basically putting stuff into their algorithm. They're putting in building blocks like, you know, cells, organic materials, and what they want this organism to evolve to do. And they've got this algorithm that's just simulating evolution and, you know, giving them back randomly generated designs. So, you know, given these organic materials, these cells in, and we want it to walk, we want it to move, we want it to grab onto objects. And they're getting back randomly generated designs that could come from the process of evolution, from their building blocks to a multicellular organism. It's kind of crazy.
So basically, we're telling this computer, hey, here's a bunch of sandwich ingredients. Here's mustard, here's rye bread, here's white bread, here's bologna, here's peanut butter, here's jelly, here's ketchup. And they're just throwing us random sandwiches, most of which are vile.
Right, so you could get back, you know, like a peanut butter, ketchup, and bologna sandwich. And, you know, you're not going to be too happy.
Right. So that's not the outcome they're looking for. They're trying to weed out those.
And like, this ain't it.
This ain't it.
But, yeah, so, you know, that's only step one, though. So they're getting back to these random, this random, you know, assortment of organisms. So then the next part after they do that is they're basically going to, like, open world RPG sandbox this shit. They're going to take these random generated designs and they're going to run them through a physics-based simulation. So they're going to, you know, simulate them actually moving around in a real environment.
Mm-hmm.
And they're going to see if, you know, they can do the things that they were designed to do. Do they actually
play Unreal Tournament?
Yeah. So like I said, they're almost like playing an open world RPG with these little randomly generated designs. You know, they're running them through this simulation to see, can they move? Does it look like they're going to be able to grab onto objects? Does it look like they're going to be able to contract? Whatever it is they were designed to do.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then here's where we filter out the vile sandwiches, or the organisms that, you know, that you look at and you're like, yeah, that's probably not going to work. How did we get that anyway?
Less than ideal.
Right. So at this point, you know, after these simulations happen, the ones that suck and don't really do what they were designed to do are removed.
Okay.
So
now do they remove them personally, or is the AI recognizing, based off the simulations, hey, these don't move in the most, like, I don't know, they don't move in the most efficient way?
Well, they're kind of scored, so it's like, you know, you're open world sandboxing, but someone's sitting there grading you on how well you're doing.
Okay.
So they get a score, and it's really just, they're removed based on that score. If they don't hit a certain threshold, they're tossed.
10 out of 10.
Right, so they take away the ones that receive a poor performance score, and then those designs are overwritten by more random designs. So okay. They keep the good ones, they overwrite the bad ones. And then they do this whole process, simulate evolution, sandbox it, take out the bad ones, 99 times. So the idea is by the end of these 99 repetitions of this whole process, you're left with nothing but a bunch of good designs, or theoretically good designs.
The ones that perform the best given the circumstances of the simulation.
Yeah. So it's an important distinction, though, you know, because they're simulated to perform well. We haven't actually gotten to testing, do they actually, yet. But, you know, this is the kind of the baseline of the whole thing.
That makes sense.
So that's step one. They made the robots out of frogs.
Made the robots out of frogs. Check that box.
Right. So step two, now we're going to move on to step two of their process, the robustness boogaloo.
Tell me about this boogaloo.
So step two in this process is, you know, actually, it doesn't start to get super interesting yet. I mean, the whole thing's kind of pretty interesting, but it doesn't get too intense yet. But as I jokingly called it, the robustness boogaloo, that's actually kind of what's going on here. So they're going to take these designs, they're going to run them through what they call a robustness filter.
Okay.
So what they're trying to do here is, now, it's great if they can do the thing that they're designed to do in a simulation. But in the simulation, you know, because there's limits to what they can do with the simulation, they're only testing or simulating, can it do the thing it was designed to do without any sort of interference, right?
Right.
Because they need designs that are capable first before they test them any further. So the robustness basically means, you know, in scientific terms, they're going to run these designs through a filter to simulate whether they can continue performing their function in the face of noise. So what that means in not science terms, for anybody who's never heard that before, they're basically just trying to mess with the thing and see if it can continue doing its job, its function, while they're messing with it. And that messing with it can come in the form of a whole bunch of different, like, environmental influences.
Blast it with sound.
I mean, they could blast it with sound, literally blast it with noise.
Right.
But in these instances, it usually more refers to something like, you know, they'll change the pH to be less than ideal. They'll change something about the environment to be less than ideal. And can these simulated designs keep doing what they're designed to do when they're messing with the environment? Because, you know,
okay,
it's great if it simulates well, but none of that matters if, as soon as the environment is any sort of less than ideal, it fails.
Right.
Because then how are you going to use that for anything practical later on?
Right. And especially because if we'll later talk about these being potentially used in medicine, each person's body is slightly different from another. So, like, if they don't work in multiple environments, they don't really work, do they?
Right, exactly. So if, you know, if they can't tolerate environmental perturbation, you know, what use are they? Useless frog bots.
Yeah. And we don't want no useless frog bots.
It's true. We only want the most useful frog bots.
Frog bots in disguise.
So Autotoads and Decepitfrogs?
I love Autotoads and Decepitfrogs. Please continue.
Alright, so after they determine which ones are the auditors and which ones are the Decepticons, we move on to step three of their process, right? So, summarize so far, we've simulated evolution, we've open world sandbox to see if they can do their job, and we've seen if they can continue to do their job according to a simulation through environmental perturbation. So now we get to the step that, you know, when I was reading this, I kind of thought this would be step one, but it wasn't.
Right.
Step three is basically them sitting there saying, well, can we even build these things?
Right.
But, I mean, I guess I see Marissa doing it both ways, but they're basically now seeing, can we build these? Like, is this possible? Because the algorithm that generates the designs, while it takes in the building blocks and the intended job of these things, it doesn't really take into account any sort of, like, biological issues with creating these things.
Right.
Because the end goal is these things are going to be built out of cells. They're going to be built out of actual living material. So that's something that has to be considered. So,
right, and the AI just tells you, hey, here's how the things that perform the best look. Right?
Yeah, but careful. We're mixing up distinctions again. And I'm only raising or mixing up terms again. I'm only raising this point because it kind of goes on to the whole bigger issue.
Okay.
What's starting this thing isn't actually an AI. It's just a machine learning algorithm. So it's just one little part of what makes up an AI. And I'm just making this distinction to kind of stress just how complicated these things can be.
So this is a brain cell inside of a full-ass brain that's working on its own individual problem.
Exactly. So you can think of it like that. The algorithm is kind of like, you know, the brain cell, the singular thought, the inside of the brain, the deep learning, which is the neural pathway simulation, which is inside of the person, the AI.
Okay. That works.
It's not a perfect explanation, but it right. kind of gets the point across, you know?
Yeah, yeah, I get it.
So now they're taking these designs that came through the robustness filter. They're like, okay, this design works. It does its job, and it can continue to work if the environment is changing, if the environment's less than ideal. So now we're going to look at, can we even build this thing? So they're evaluating whether they can be built from two different standpoints, right? The first one's going to be suitability. So when they say suitability, they mean like, are the cells, the kind of cells they're using, suitable to be configured like this?
Right.
Because, so one of the big problems they're running into is that this algorithm would spit out designs that were way too concave or had too much concavity mm-hmm. or open space. And these designs worked in theory because they weren't taking into account the actual behavior of cells.
Right.
But they stopped working in practice because these things are being made out of stem cells, right? That's the only, mm-hmm. that's the only way you can kind of really get these things to develop into anything, because they're made out of pluripotent stem cells from, I believe, the scientific name is Xenopus laevis, which I think is like the African clawed frog or something, which sounds a little bit terrifying.
It's not that scary. It's pretty cute, honestly.
I don't know, the name sounds kind of terrifying.
This is the claws.
But one of the characteristics of stem cells that you get is that they'll fill in these spaces, right?
Mm-hmm.
So like these designs, which are too concave, have too much open space in them, they're thrown out because the behavior of stem cells dictates that they're likely to close the spaces or right. fill in that concavity, and then the design's shot. It's not going to do what it's supposed to do anymore. Design integrity's gone, so they toss it.
Got it.
The other design factor they're looking at for can they build it is what they call scalability. So they're using primarily two different kinds of tissue here. They were taking pluripotent stem cells as their kind of soft tissue, and they were also using cardiac progenitor cells from the same frogs. So basically cells, embryonic cells that will naturally develop in the cardiomyocytes, or like, you know, heart muscle.
So they probably twitch.
Right.
Or contract, because that's what hearts do.
Right, that's exactly it. So the soft tissue is kind of like, that kind of ties into the scalability thing. The muscle tissue isn't really a place where they can add things or add complex systems to these things. So as the name implies, they're not scalable for bigger, better, harder, faster, stronger things.
Do it better, make it better. And then we got sued by Daft Punk.
Please don't sue us, Daft Punk. This is only our third episode. We can't pay you.
Oh God, I can't go into debt to Daft Punk.
So they're looking at these things. They're scalable. And if the design, or if the algorithm spit out a design that has too much muscle tissue, for example, right? They're not going to be able to scale it up to do more complex things in the future, because there won't be enough soft tissue to insert more complex systems, because the soft tissue is where they would insert new systems or add things to the organism, to the design.
Got it.
Additionally, if there's too much muscle tissue, you know, as we've all been taught by bro science surrounding working out, muscle burns more calories than fat.
Oh, I thought you were going to tell me you get too swole, you can't move. Like, you see those guys coming out of the gym with their trapezius all out of, like, a big-ass triangle coming out of their head, and they can't turn their head at all.
I mean, that's true, but in this case, the bro science was right. Your muscle tissue has a higher metabolic cost than soft tissue. Right. So if these things are, you know, little tiny balls of muscle, then their metabolic cost is going to be too high, and the lifespan of the organism is going to go down.
Makes sense.
I mean, we'll talk about that a little more in a bit when we talk about, like, future implications, but if these things can't survive for very long wherever their environment is, then they're not really going to be useful because they won't be able to do anything that matters.
Mm-hmm.
So that's step three in their process, is figuring out if they can even build these things.
Can we?
Yes, we can, in fact.
Yes!
Step four tells us, yes, we can. So now they've got they've got it. You know, they've got their plans, they've got their design. It's been simulated, it's been run through a robustness filter, it's been run through a build filter to determine if it's even possible and or worth building. So now we get to the, I guess for me, the interesting part, where they actually made little microorganisms, and they're not robots as we, you know, you traditionally think robot, you think, you know, bundle of circuits, completely electronic.
Right.
But
there's nothing synthetic about these.
Right, which is the whole point. You know, they're artificially, they're designing, you know, some might say they're actually kind of playing God a little bit, and they're designing little organic life forms with a degree of intelligence. I mean, I guess there has to be a degree of intelligence in order for it to carry out a selected job, right?
It's so hard to determine whether or not it's, like, intelligent, or if it's just doing a thing because it acts... Like, there's always a chance it's accidentally doing a thing, right? Like, hey, in one experiment we did, they just moved in circles, which ended up, they collected these little pellets. So, did they know to collect those pellets, or is that just how they moved in that environment? Like, because I imagine difference in pH, or, like, certain nutrients present, like, if there's sodium and potassium present, that could change, you know, how the pumps in these cells are working, and it could cause these cells to, like, twitch and stuff.
Yeah, and I mean, is it actual intelligence? I don't know. That's kind of more of a...
Right. It's very philosophical question. Debate.
You know, you can hear the discussion on that. Tune into the Weird Philosophy Show podcast.
Ooh, can't wait for that episode.
I'm kidding. That doesn't exist yet.
It exists. It exists. Don't let Dan lie
but,
to you.
But that's, you know, kind of... You get into a little bit of more philosophical, metaphysical discussion at that point. Are these things considered intelligent? I don't know. But right. They do a thing they were designed to do, so...
That they do.
Still, to a degree, they're creating organic life forms. They're creating life forms to do a job, and it's kind of crazy.
Yes. It's absolutely crazy. So, how close are we to Jurassic Park is what I want to know. But I guess we'll get into that and the implications.
Yeah. So, yeah, after, you know, they've gone through these several filters of the design, now they're like, all right, well, we filtered it. I guess let's try to build it. So they basically take pluripotent stem cells. So for anybody listening that's not familiar with, you know, stem cell terminology, pluripotent stem cells are basically stem cells that can become any body cell at all. These are the kind of stem cells when you hear the big spooky stem cell research that is not really controversial anymore, but was for the longest time. These are the kind of stem cells they're talking about.
Right.
Because these kind of stem cells can differentiate into any body cell. So
cool.
So they take these stem cells and they harvest them from the blastula stage. That's just a developmental stage of the frog embryo.
It's a ball of cells.
It's basically a ball of cells.
It's not quite hollow yet, because that's the next stage, but they get them before they start to hollow, because once it starts to hollow is when the cells start to differentiate into different parts.
So yeah, they're basically taking these embryos when they're still a ball of cells, and they're harvesting these pluripotent stem cells before they can differentiate any further. Because what happens is these stem cells differentiate into new stem cell lines that they're not differentiated into their final cell type, but these next stem cells are set to become a certain kind of cell. Like, this right. is going to become a skin cell, or a muscle cell, or a liver cell.
Tooth cell. And that's when you tell me that there's no such thing as tooth cells.
There's not a such thing as tooth cells, Sean. I'm sorry
to disappoint you. Well, fuck, I've been lied to my whole life. I don't even deserve this degree anymore.
Okay, so then they get these... They have these stem cells, they're harvested, they basically make a little pool of them, right? Yep. And they just let them grow.
Yes.
They let them grow, divide until they've got the appropriate number of cells for the design they're trying to create. So then, after that, they basically perform microsurgery on these things, right? They use little tiny forceps and wire cautery electrodes to either pull or burn cells out of this thing.
The pictures of this in the paper are actually really cool. I highly recommend any listener, go check out this paper, and if nothing more, look at the pictures. They're really bizarre.
For anyone that does want to do that, as usual, we will have the link to the paper in the description.
Yeah.
So I would highly recommend looking at some of this stuff. It's fascinating. But they're basically performing microsurgery, like pulling cells, burning cells out of this thing, Until they've got a little cell blob that closely approximates, or as closely approximates, the simulated design as they can get.
For the most part, they kind of look like the head crabs from Half-Life.
Yeah, and it's actually a little bit disturbing.
Like, that's really what they look like. They're like this weird little mound, and they've got these four little, like, node legs just coming off the bottom of them. They're very interesting looking.
Yeah, and creepy. Creepy. But, so at that point, they've got a ball of, well, I guess it's not a ball anymore, it's a head crab looking lump of soft tissue. And then, they need the thing to be able to move. So they take this head crab looking lump of soft tissue, and they start layering or embedding the cardiac progenitor cells I mentioned earlier into this lump of soft tissue. And the idea there is that these are the kind of cells that evolve into, or develop into, not evolve, develop into cardiomyocytes. So it'll be muscle cells. So They let these things move around by they put the cardiac progenitor cells at appropriate points in the organism, so that when these cells contract, it'll cause the movement that's appropriate for their function. So, like, you know, if it's, you got your little head crab looking thing and it's got to crawl around the environment, maybe it'll contract at the quote unquote legs so that the thing will move around.
I kind of imagine them doing like a little, like, side to side shimmy, like they're moving their shoulders.
Well, apparently they tested quite a few different things. So, which leads me to the last step in their pipeline here. They filtered them, they've designed them, they built them, now we have to test them.
Test it up!
So, up until this point, all the tests have been, if you recall, all the tests have been simulations, right? They don't, yes. They don't know what's going to happen, so they take
these
designs.
They just think they know what's going to happen.
And the word they used in the paper was, these constructed designs are deployed, which...
Deploy the boy!
Because I imagine like a little squad of like these little frogbot blob things just being deployed into the environment to accomplish their mission.
I love it. It's good imagery.
So they basically unleash these things in an environment. I don't know if they mentioned, you know, what exactly the environment was, but they were deployed in an environment. And they were tested to see, okay, well, now that we've got the things actually built, can they actually do the thing they were simulated to do? They actually observed several behaviors of these things, because, you know, they didn't design the things to do just one thing. They had designs that were designed to move, or locomotion, right? So they observed object manipulation, designs that were designed to actually be able to, I guess, use their little head crab legs and move things around. Some of them were designed for object transport. So can they grab some sort of molecule object and, you know, actually take it with them to somewhere else, versus object manipulation, which is like, can they just move something out of the way, for example, or just push something? But object transport is like, you know, they're testing, can they actually pick the thing up and take it with them?
Right.
So, you know, this is kind of important for any sort of future usefulness. So they observed them for all these different behaviors, and then they compared them to the simulation that I mentioned all the way back from step one, the simulation of can they do their job. So what they're trying to do here is they're trying to, you know, this is where the learning part of machine learning comes in, because they're trying to teach their algorithm, if you will. Right, so they're taking the simulation score, they're comparing it to the actual performance score, seeing if they match up, and then the algorithm is looking at other data points in the design to basically trying to discern what features of these objects will result in good performance scores in actual testing, not just simulation.
Right.
So in that way, it's basically learning. It's trying to figure out, establish relationships between certain features, be it cell placement, number of cells, strategic placement of an indent. You can really pick any feature, but it's basically just trying to discern relationships between the
different
features
models.
The features of the design and high performance scores.
So basically, the computer kicks out a score. Then we take it into the environment. We build the shape that the computer tells us to build, because it says, hey, these ones perform the best, or should. Then we test them. And then we give them our own grade. And then we take our grades and we compare them to the computer's grades, and then tell the computer, hey, here's how they actually fared in reality. What are the similarities in the ones that performed better than all the other ones? So, like you were saying, it could be, hey, there's 12 more cells on this side, and for whatever reason, that actually makes it, you know, move more efficiently.
Yeah, that's pretty much what's going on. The only important distinction there is that we have to make sure that if we're giving them a score or grading their performance, we have to make sure that we're using the same criteria, the same grading scale right. as the simulation, because otherwise the results aren't comparable.
Right.
But yeah, that's effectively what's happening. And they're using this to teach their algorithm, you know, the learning part of their machine learning. And what this eventually does is that you eventually get designs that perform higher, and you start being able to add constraints that you want your design to conform to, in addition to just, because the first iteration of this algorithm is just, will it perform, right?
Right.
But as you gather more data and keep feeding it back into the algorithm, then you can then do stuff like, okay, well, we want it to perform, but additionally, we need it to have this shape, right? Because what that allows you to do is create specialized, I guess we'll call them organobots, for whatever purpose you're trying to fulfill. Like, let's say you, and this is going to get into, you know, future implications a little bit, but let's say you're sending these things into someone's body, right, to deliver something, to mm-hmm. do something. You need them not only to, like, for example, you need them not only to be able to transport something, so that's object transport, right?
Mm-hmm.
But you also need these things to be less than a certain size, otherwise they can't go where they need to go, right?
They also need to be able to figure out where to go.
Like, right, so that's the kind of thing you start getting into once you start, you know, feeding the data back into the algorithm, because now you can say, whereas we started with, oh, we needed to do this function, now you start being able to say, oh, we need to do this function, but also we need it to meet these specific requirements.
Right.
It's really so that's cool. The whole learning process. And that's the whole process. And, you know, broken down, I guess it's not as, it's not quite as advertised making robots out of frogs, but it's really kind of crazy that this is kind of like one of the big stepping stones into, like, actual artificial intelligence, because it's made out of organic material, but they're effectively creating artificial intelligence here.
Will we ever get to a part in society where the T-1000 is hunting down humanity to destroy it?
Except this time, the T-1000 is made out of frogs.
Deceptifrogs. Decepitoads? Autotoads and Decepitifrogs.
Yes. But, yeah, so, you know, that all being said, that this is basically, you know, that's the results of their paper. That, you know, the results were, you know, our process works.
Right.
You know, we're able to run it through this pipeline and it works.
Yeah. It's obviously currently very labor intensive because they're physically building them themselves by, you know, cutting and placing cells.
Right. But, you know, something like this is, you know, it's kind of crazy as far as the future implications go, because this is basically the sci-fi movies, the sci-fi crazy stuff, you know, that started popping up in the 80s when sci-fi really started booming, 70s, 80s. This is it. Like, you know, they're creating artificial life forms. And, you know, one of the big uses they mentioned is, I know there has been previous research with, like, you know, bacteriophages,
Right, yeah.
The precursor to, like, nanobots, I guess. But this is, that's kind of what they had in mind when they were talking about all this stuff. You know, they hope, I think this was a thought mentioned in the paper, is they hope to get to these, to the point where they could use something like this to create organisms to manipulate things inside the body, you know?
Yeah, I saw they were talking about, like, this could be the future of cancer drug delivery. Like, you know, here's these little creatures we're going to pump into you. They can find the cancer. They can destroy the cancer because, I don't know, we attached, you know, certain cells to them that will just break down cancerous cells. It's really impressive stuff when you think about it. Like, this could be a game changer if we can get it to a point where these things can just be manufactured.
Right, and the even bigger deal is, like, targeting. It's targeted. Like, right. If these things totally work the way they want them to, that would get rid of one of the biggest drawbacks of, like, you know, going with the cancer treatment. one of the biggest drawbacks of widely used treatments for cancer right now is that it's not targeted. It's kind of just like they shoot your body with radiation and hope it kills the cancer more than it kills you.
Right. And that's obviously incredibly taxing on a person's physical form. Like, you're not going to be a healthy person after chemo.
Right. Unfortunately, you're not going to turn into Dr. Manhattan or something.
Yeah. But so this could change that game. Like, we don't have to be damaging people anymore to heal them or in hopes of beating the cancer before we can, you know, kill the person.
Right. And this could possibly change the landscape of several different, like, you know, inside the body manipulations. Like, anything that was invasive, this technology could come along far enough. You know, maybe procedures that are invasive, treatments that are invasive, can become less so, because if they can get these things reliably doing what they need them to do, they just inject you with a bunch of frog bots and have them do the job instead of however they were going to do it before. And
I need frog bots to eat my tonsils and appendix. Problem solved.
Sounds disgusting.
But like, what's really cool about them is, because they're stem cells, they're not indestructible, but they can rebuild themselves. Like, they're really hardy cells to be using in this type of thing. So it's like, okay, let's say, you know, somehow in the delivery method, they get a little bumped up or bruised up, they can put themselves back together. Like, you know, you don't have to worry about these things being damaged over time, because they're just going to keep fixing themselves.
Yeah, but then you get into, like, well, how do you tell it when to stop fixing
themselves? Right.
But all of a sudden, you are the T-1000 made out of frogs.
Oh, man, I can't wait to be the T-1000 made out of frogs.
I don't think you want to be the T-1000 made out of frogs, Sean.
So what else can we do with this type of, like, nanobot technology? Besides the fact that we haven't even touched on the fact that we're creating life. Is this a species now? Is, like, is this real life? Like, what constitutes real life?
I don't know. This is some sci-fi shit. Like, this is the beginning of the creation of artificial life forms. Like they have cloned things before, sure, but I put that in kind of like a different category, because this is, they're just like legitimately simulating evolution to design a life form. They're not making a copy of something that's already there.
With, like, literally building blocks. Like, mind you, they're not currently altering DNA, but feasibly in the future, they could, because the way that it sounds like the AI is working is it's looking at the cell's genetic code, and it's using that genetic code to create shapes, body shapes.
Well, they're not quite there yet. It's not actually looking at the genetic code. It's just kind of looking at the cells and lumping them together. Yeah.
But feasibly, in the future, it could be looking at the genes and say, like, hey, we could literally grow these if we have this gene sequence in this order.
I mean, that's not too far-fetched, because there's already a whole lot of machine learning surrounding genetic analysis. I mean, even I have worked in the past with some machine learning stuff doing genome analysis, so it's not too far-fetched, because the technology already exists.
Right. Like, it would... I'm sure that's probably already sequenced, to be honest, but, like, yeah, it's really possible that feasibly there will come a time where people do not have to do microsurgery to create these nanobots or xenobots or frog robots. You could just grow them in a petri dish.
yeah, I really could, and that's how eventually we wind up with Total Recall. Yeah. All kinds of crazy stuff. But, I mean, this is the beginning of, I guess, what could turn out to be a very, very prolific field of research in the coming years, depending on where they go with this. I mean, there's still a lot of hurdles, because there's still, you know, it's a far cry from putting blobs of cells together in a way determined by an algorithm to getting independently functional artificial life forms that you can grow.
Right.
So, like, they're not even close to that, especially considering, like, you know, what they're doing right now is basically burning or plucking blobs of cells to be in the right configuration.
They're playing with micro Play-Doh.
Basically, yeah, they're playing with moving, they're playing with basically microscopic flubber.
Yeah, I mean, it's a good analogy. It's this, you know, artificial biological life that's capable of doing simple tasks and could have major ramifications, positive ramifications, hopefully, in the medical field. Like, some amazing stuff that could be done with this.
I mean, I, for one, I'm pretty excited to see where this kind of technology goes. I've always been really interested in the machine learning, you know, AI kind of stuff. So,
yeah,
absolutely. I'm really looking forward to seeing where the scientific community might be able to take this kind of stuff.
Yeah, I totally agree. And I think to keep pushing this forward, you need to talk to your politicians about allowing stem cell research.
Yeah,
End of story.
Yeah.
So that about wraps up this paper. Oh. It's super interesting. I highly recommend you guys read it. You know, the paper is going to be linked down in the episode description. Please check it out.
That was just an interesting dive into frog robots and the future of artificial life. But that about does it for the scalable pipeline for designing reconfigurable organisms. So now I'm going to throw it over to you, Sean, for this week's featured creature.
Thank you, Dan. This week's featured creature is Venus's flower basket.
What is that, Sean?
These are a species of deep sea glass sponges.
They're made out of glass?
Actually, kind of, yes. So this genus of sponges is called Euplectella, and they are typically found between 100 and 1,000 meters depth, generally speaking. And they are like these really gorgeous, stark white, tubular sponges that are made of like this really beautiful, hard lattice.
Gorgeous is not a word I ever thought I would hear used to describe a sponge, but go on.
Yeah, generally speaking, you wouldn't. On average, they're about 25 centimeters long, so roughly 10 inches. And some species can even live to be between 11,000 and 15,000 years old.
The eternal sponges.
The eternal sponges. So they actually got this name, glass sponge, because of the siliceous spicules that make up the rigid lattice. So siliceous meaning that they are made from silicon. So same stuff that makes up sand and glass and, you know, a lot of electronic bits now. So oftentimes these sponges actually have, like, they become the permanent houses for a species of deep sea shrimp. Like, basically the shrimp gets in there when it's, you know, a wee juvenile, and then it gets stuck in there because the kind of the sponge closes as it ages. So generally speaking, there is a male and female shrimp in a lot of these sponges. So in Japan, they were actually given as wedding gifts for a really long time, and probably still in more traditional families, because the sponge was viewed as a cage. Like, these shrimp were married and there was no escape but death.
So they're eternal kidnapping sponges.
Well, I mean, they don't kidnap them. They house them. That's the nicer way of putting it.
They house them, but they can never escape.
So yeah, these were a really popular wedding gift in Japan for a while. And it's kind of like their version of death do us part, because there is no escape from the glass sponge.
Till death or imprisonment within a glass sponge do we part.
Till death do us part, and the sponge devours our corpses. Thank you all for joining us. That's been our featured creature. Dan, take it away.
All right, guys, that's going to do it for this week. Thank you all for joining us. As always, our theme song is by Sean's brother, Jesse Ricca. You can find him on Instagram at Jesse Ricca. As always, if you guys enjoy listening to the podcast, subscribe to us on Spotify and Google Podcasts. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram for updates. If you want to share any ideas with us, if you've seen something you would like us to discuss, or if you just want to share what you think of what we've done so far, follow us on Twitter and Instagram. And if you or a loved one is hearing impaired, our YouTube channel now has our episode with auto-generated closed captions. Tune in next time and see some more weird shit. Bye.
Bye!